Good morning and welcome to this special meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2022. And I say special because I'm especially pleased to be able to welcome members today who participated on the Citizens Panel on Participation and who are going to be discussing with us their report and the recommendations that arose from it. Can I begin by saying we have apologies from our colleague Fergus Ewing, who's not able to be with us today. And sadly, at the last minute, Alexander Stewart, who was supposed to be joining us remotely from deepest, darkest Bridge of Allen, where I thought communication still reached. But in any event, he has had communications issues and is unable to join us this morning. Of our committee members present, David Torrance and Paul Sweeney, can I just ask them if they're content to discuss item three in private later on? They are, thank you. So that brings us to the immediately to the substance of today's meeting, which is the committee's public participation inquiry. And we have with us round the table members of the 19 who were able to join in that work. Paul McDonald, Gillian Rowan, John Sultman, and Maria Schwartz have joined us, and Ronnie Patterson, who I can now see. I take it that's a mirror on the wall behind you, Mr. Patterson, and not a porthole. So I'm assuming you're on the you're with us from home and not on board a ship somewhere.
Most definitely, I'm not.
Well, welcome to you. And this is actually our first opportunity to talk with you. I mean, I was very pleased to join the group when they all looked rather nervously at one another over their first something to eat at the start, but I know that it's been a tremendous experience in which everybody has really found their feet and enjoyed enormously. So before I go into a discussion of all of this, then I think we just go round the table and allow everyone to introduce themselves. And obviously, I'm Jackson Carlow, convener of the committee, and I'll come to you first.
My name's Gillian Ruane. I'm from Dumfries.
David Torrance, MSP.
Paul McDonald, I'm from Glasgow.
Maria Schwartz, I'm from Edinburgh.
Hi, I'm Paul Sweeney, and I'm a member of the Scottish Parliament from Glasgow.
John Saltman from Glasgow.
And then we have got a series of our officials who you may have you met. They've met you at various stages along the way. So, but they hide anonymously from the public, so they'll be working quietly in the background and led by our Clark Lim. So before the committee's remit was extended this session, I mean the Public Petitions Committee, and to the consternation a little bit of my predecessor, Joanne Lamont, who was the convener of this committee in the last session, because public petitions are almost essentially the people's business before Parliament, in that uniquely almost in parliaments across the world, a single individual's signature is all it takes for a petition to come before this committee and to be considered and potentially progressed. And some very important pieces of legislation have subsequently followed through all of this: free care of the elderly, the extension of care for early onset dementia, the women's mesh scandal, and the way in which the government have resolved that. All of these are issues that in recent years have come up through this committee. And so Joanne, my predecessor, was concerned that we would dilute that focus. But I think we've managed so far not to do that. And I think that it has been a natural coupling with the work of this committee that we look at the whole question of deliberative democracy, much of which was initiated as an inquiry following the previous presiding officer Ken McIntosh's Commission on Parliamentary Reform in the last session, which very much suggested that in this session, or actually earlier, but because of the pandemic that really wasn't possible, we should explore the ways in which deliberative democracy might be extended. And that is what initiated this committee's inquiry into public participation. And we wanted to look at how people's voices were heard. We wanted to know, when the Scottish Parliament is developing new laws or policies, how people feel those they are affected by those. And a recognition that the Parliament doesn't hear from some groups of communities and how we can ensure that the views and opinions of everyone are included in the work that we do. And we started off with a consultation with people across Scotland. We heard from 460 people and organisations who told us what they would like to see by way of improvements to allow us to engage more effectively as a parliament now into its third decade. And as part of that, the citizens panel was established. Out of thousands of people who were contacted, we were able to have 19 people who broadly reflect the demographic makeup of Scotland, who met in Holyrood, then met online several times, and then came together again in Holyrood. And throughout these sittings, they heard from MSPs, some of my colleagues, from Scottish Parliament officials, from third sector organisations, leading academics about democracy and public participation, and also from members of the media. And we now know that the panel, having gone through all that endeavour, has come forward with a report, which we're here to discuss this morning, with some 17 recommendations on how Holyrood's work might improve, how it might reflect, how it might meet the needs of the full range of communities that we represent. And particularly focusing on those that I think in through discussion, and I think understood by many of us, even subconsciously, have been underrepresented in the deliberations that the Parliament has entered into. I mean, we can keep ourselves very busy as a Parliament, but not notice really in passing that there are voices that are not being heard. And the recommendations you've come up with are wide-ranging. I've thoroughly enjoyed digesting them, reflecting on some of them, and how they might, in practical terms, affect the work of the Parliament and move towards implementation if the Parliament was to find favour with them. I hope you will make a ringing clarion call to saying that you hope the Parliament will embrace your recommendations, and that this report is one that we as a committee will be empowered to take forward and represent to our colleagues and to Parliament on your behalf. And I think it would be important as part of this exercise that the recommendations themselves do lead to potentially additional changes to the way that we do business here at Holyrood. Now, as we move to our discussion, I understand that there are different areas that you will individually potentially be leading us on. My colleagues will, and I will follow on and ask just in as free-flowing a way as we can. Ronnie, if you can at any time, you are the only person who is joining us online this morning. So if you raise a hand or something, I will see that. So I'll know that you want to come in. And I think with probably the best place to start is really on your general experience of being involved in the panel and how you feel the process you went through was. And Ronnie, I'll come to you since you're joining us from your living room this morning, and ask you if you'd like to tell us how you felt the process had been.
I absolutely loved the process we were involved in. I suppose you would put me in the sort of demographic as ignorant and arrogant to politics. And when I first came in and realised it wasn't really about politics, but when you spoke about deliberative democracy, to take the group as we were, the 19 that came together, and to be able to discuss it in a kind of adult, normal way. None of us sort of well versed, I suppose, in politics or academia, but we came up with these recommendations 100% as a group. Now, whether that was this 19 or another 19 or another 19, I think it was amazing that we all agreed at the end of the day that these were our recommendations. And I think that proves and shows the power of that deliberative democracy. Together we actually come up with these. So I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I've loved the process.
Excellent. Maria?
A great opportunity to come together. A lot of people had their own ideas and others could contribute, and we could expand on these ideas and come up with even better plans. And it was good to actually, we were actually able to test out some ideas because there were actually some ideas that we liked within the group. And then we put them forward to target groups and we got immediate feedback, which was really good.
John?
I found it very useful to the range of information that was presented to us. Some confirmed things I maybe thought I knew and others completely dispelled illusions I had. Certainly seeing what we saw and watching the group come together, and as Maria said, the way we were able to test ideas out on each other and with third parties, it was really enlightening, and I'm quite proud of what we've done.
Gillian?
Yep, I loved the whole experience from start to finish. I found that it was a wide range of representation, young people underrepresented, but they certainly had been invited. I loved it. I thought the level of expertise put in front of us from various organisations were amazing. And we all came together, we debated it respectfully, nobody railroaded over anyone else. And collectively we've come up with the recommendations and we hope that you guys will implement them.
And Paul?
Yep, I found it really interesting. I mean, I've always been a follower of politics, but I didn't even know the difference between parliament and government, literally when I came in here. I didn't really understand the separation of that structure. I suppose I've always wanted to sort of engage with what's going on in the government. I've never really known how to do it. I've always felt quite frustrated about it. So it was very interesting to see that there are systems in place and well, potentially even better improved systems. And I think if more people, and I found this in the panel, a lot of people had the same issues as me, the same frustrations. And I think that comes out in distrust in government in general and sort of people perhaps posting angry things online because they just feel frustrated that they don't know how to engage. So I think it's if it opens that up, then it'll be a very positive thing.
Thank you. And that's going to be the first area we come to. And I know you and Maria are going to be leading on that. And I think for those who may be following our proceedings this morning, it's important just to say again that the 19 who came together weren't nominated as such. They're not representatives of organisations or third-party sectors or bodies from a very, very wide random selection of the public. We arrived at the 19, and the whole point was that we were bringing into this inquiry voices that are not coming with any particular baggage or association with political activism or the third sector or voluntary organisations or anything of that. And it really was a fresh look and input. And that, I think, is then quite remarkable that through that process that you have all come together with such a striking report. And the recommendations fall into really a series of different obvious headings, the first of which we're going to look at is on community engagement, which is the subject Paul was just starting on there. And I know Maria and Paul are going to lead us on this area of the report. So I'll allow, I don't know which of you is going to take the initiative, but whichever of you is going to do so, please do. Maria, your name comes first, so I don't know whether you're taking us in.
That's fine. Community engagement. So our first point was to remove barriers to participation so that everyone has an equal opportunity to be involved in the work of the parliament. So what we have discovered throughout this process is that many different people have many different reasons why they may struggle to engage with parliament. It may be disability, mobility issues, so they can't get to parliament. They may have issues, or they may not be technologically literate, so they have issues working a computer, can't access the parliament website. For other people, it's time. Therefore, we need to be looking at different solutions because there are so many different barriers to solve the problem. One of these aspects is, so one of them, for example, is cost. So if you look at the fifth paragraph, raise awareness that the Scottish Parliament will provide payments which addresses the cost of barriers that people face when coming to the Parliament, and taking part in engagement activities such as travel expenses, lost income from time of work, childcare and additional costs related to accessibility requirements. So transport, time of work, childcare, these are all big barriers we've identified that working adults struggle with, for example. ensure access for people with English as a second language. So there are a lot of foreigners here that where English is not the first language, and there may be a barrier with that, on the other hand. And also, there's a significant number of people with learning disabilities, and therefore we suggested that participation should be supported with technologies or promoting and increasing the use of easy read of flyers, documentation, legislation that's being put out by the parliament for the public.
And the second recommendation was to create opportunities for... The second recommendation is create opportunities for people to use and share their lived experience and to engage in issues that they care about. We heard from a number of experts on things that we can upskill and educate ourselves very quickly if we need to. We don't have the bandwidth to feel passionate about everything all the time, but when we do need to have the channels there to engage, when identifying witnesses, ensure an even balance between academic and professional experts. One thing we found was people felt that there was a lot of professional experts, or the opinions were coming from the media or from MSPs themselves, but people felt that they weren't really reflecting their actual lived experience of these problems and these issues. Which is why they felt quite strongly about the use of deliberative democracy, really. Number three.
Okay, thank you. Raising awareness of parliamentary business in plain and transparent language, including visual media. Latest data, post-pandemic literacy levels show that about 33% of people in Scotland struggle with reading. Therefore, plain language and visual media are actually important to include these people as well. Undertaking research into the general public's level of trust and knowledge about the everyday work of the Scottish Parliament. So I believe a lot more research is necessary. You consider us 19, we are actually a very small sample size. So if you base all of your future engagement only on us 19 people, there is the possibility that you're just kind of going to be wasting money. You know, before you spend thousands on an engagement campaign, hoping to increase awareness, you want to make sure that it's actually going to help and actually going to reach the people, and it's not just going to be ignored.
And did Ronnie want to speak on point four? I think it was.
Oh, did the boss.
And the yes.
One of the points that came up was maybe to have some sort of mobile unit, which is basically, when we're talking about people, diverse voices and communities being influenced, a lot of people don't have access to everything. So to go out into the community personally with some sort of mobile unit, or maybe using in more remote areas, library buses, and in some way to promote the work of the Parliament, and also for people in the community who don't have good access, to get more involved, where they can share opinions and maybe just vote in certain kind of little aspects of what's happening in the community. And I think that would be a great way of engagement and certainly a more personal basis to promote Parliament. And I think, as they said before, we never really understood the chasm of a difference between Parliament and government. When everybody just mentions Parliament, they just think, oh, that's government. And we know now that it's not. And I think that'd be a good, that's a good one to get out to people. And what better way than to do that on a personal basis?
And point five was ensure that community engagement by MSPs doesn't exclude people that are out with community groups, including by using evening, weekends and online. And we found that the systems of engagement have become quite set in place, quite rigid, and We sort of identified multiple groups that are out with the sort of that are not getting involved. There are people that have an opinion but aren't involved in community groups. Not everyone is necessarily actively looking for ways to engage, but they also have a very strong opinion about it, but they just don't know where to start. So it's just opening that up to different means through digital engagement, through social media, providing, if it's visiting the Parliament, actually providing costs for them to engage or to provide childcare and so forth, and for that.
Can I add to this, please?
Yep.
For me personally, so this was for me the very most important point. I'm someone who works full time. I spend a lot of my time at work. I work a lot of overtime. On the weekends, I'm tired. I pay the bills, clean. So I don't have a lot of time left. So for me, for example, my biggest barrier is time. So I need something in the evenings, it's happening in the evenings on the weekends, or something I can quickly look up on my phone, because at the moment for me, I need, first of all, time to research the difference between government and parliament. I need to research how to engage with it. I need to find time how to engage with it. And a lot of it happens during the week, Monday through Friday, and I just can't take time off work for that. Thank you. The last point, create a system such as a web page where people can register and be notified about opportunities to engage. So the Parliament should create an advertisement for people to register their details and interests with the Parliament. MSPs and committees would be able to contact individuals about opportunities to engage in the work of Parliament when an issue arises that individuals are interested in. This idea was inspired by the amount of issues discussed at Parliament at any one time. Passing the public by, the solution could ensure that no one misses the chance to engage. For example, a call for view. At the moment, you need to go onto the website regularly to see if there's an update to it. How come you can't just subscribe to an alert? And if there's an update to it, you get an email alert, or there's a new call for view. And if you're interested in it, you can go and look.
Well, let's go through each of these points in turn and see whether any of my colleagues want to just pursue the discussion on them as we do. The first one was the removing the barriers to participation. And to follow up on previous research by researching different methods of engagement. Well, we're coming to that. But in terms of removing the barriers to participation and the consequences for those who might try to participate in terms of lost income or the cost of coming to here or any other arrangements they would have to put in place, any questions that arise from either from that section to either of my colleagues? Paul Sweeney?
Well, Convener, I just say thanks very much for the really impressive set of recommendations so far. I think I was really, you know, compelled by what you were saying. I think that there were really good points. I suppose there's one issue about a chilling effect that people might have in practical terms about engagement, and perhaps there needs to be some sort of statutory protection for people who want to engage in parliamentary business in some capacity, in the same way that jury duty is a legally protected thing, although it's not the same thing about compulsion of attending. But if people were wanting to engage on an issue, they had actually a legal right to do so in some way where their employer, for example, couldn't discriminate against them or prevent them from doing so. It might be over the top as a solution, but it might be something worth considering, that there might need to be some sort of statutory right for the citizens.
And I think that is contained within the recommendations as we move further forward into the report, actually.
Right, okay.
It's one of the ones
missed that one.
Was there. I mean, you also make reference to happy to translate and the ability of people to follow proceedings for whom English isn't a first language. What was your feeling about that? I was interested to know if anybody had any experience of happy to translate amongst the 19, or on what basis had it come up as being an option? How had it arisen?
I believe we had a target group that we met with, or a couple. So at some point we were split into different groups, and we met different target groups. One was young people. One was people from different cultural backgrounds. Another group was people in poverty. And I believe this came up in the group with different cultural backgrounds and immigration. Yeah, so there was just a suggestion.
Yes, I think I attended one of the kind of the informal kind of round tables that took place during the process, and I was interested to know where the experience of that facility had come from. The second recommendation is about people with lived experience, and I think probably as a committee we can all accept that. I mean, I know Parliament, both the commission I was on previously and I think also in the discussions we've had, the phrase used here is the usual suspects, which is not always a very kind thing, but it has been that in the evidence that comes to many of our committees, there have been easy-to-reach organisations who have almost become quite professional witnesses on a whole cross-range of issues, which it has maybe been too easily a default reserve for the Parliament to go to them and in passing not to necessarily seek the wider views of people with lived experience. Were there any examples when you were doing your work where you felt that had come out, that the lack of lived experience had been an issue?
No, actually, we've had a lot of lived experience. It was, I can't say if it was a majority, but we had a big amount of people come in and speak about their own experience, talking about their own backgrounds, for example, and gave their views on that.
Okay. David or Paul, anything they want to ask on that question?
Kavina, can I just say, firstly, when this was brought about, 19 individuals with such different backgrounds were going to meet, I thought this could be a recipe for disaster, should I say. But I am really, really impressed with the 17 recommendations, and you 100% agreed with it. So well done to every one of you. Around engagement and individuals with lived experience, as somebody who has been in the Parliament 11 years, and for some of us been here a lot longer, not looking at the convener, it's the same witnesses we see all the time again, and the same groups of self-interest. And to get people with lived experience, how does the Parliament really reach out to get that? To make that sort of effort to go out there into communities and find people, rather than every time we get the same, as a convener says, the same groups representing us on committee all the time.
And I think that's partly what the Citizens Panel was doing. We had 19 people who had lived experience of their own, who had not previously been engaged, and it's finding a way to access that resource more generally when we're trying to pursue our work, I imagine, is what you were trying to get us to consider. Paul?
I think it's an interesting point, actually, because just yesterday we considered stage one of the Movable Transactions Scotland Bill, which on the face of it was a Scottish Law Commission bill, which was very dry and technical and related to being able to use movable assets to raise finance or debts against, and it was primarily geared towards businesses. So, for example, barrels of whiskey, fleets of vehicles, etc. You could raise finance against, not just on land and buildings. But one of the unintended consequences that rapidly became apparent was that this could open up an entire irregular lending market to consumers, so that your kind of backstreet lenders using household goods as collateral to raise debts against, sort of kind of virtual pawnbroking. But it was only at the very last stage where that became obvious, because the whole consultation on the bill had been focused around the banking sector and the legal sector. And it was only because of this kind of lived experience that was brought through from the money advice agencies at the last minute that they realised you're potentially opening up an entire explosion of unintended consequences here. And it was only then that the government realised that stage two are going to have to amend the bill to take out consumers. But I wonder, like, that maybe is a symptom of a wider issue where, because there's such an echo chamber at times, people aren't necessarily aware in drafting legislation that there's these wider consequences. And that actually could have potentially been devastating for families, you know, if it potentially these very predatory lending practices been introduced. So just an example from yesterday, actually, in the debate in Parliament, where this kind of improvement would have actually resulted in better quality legislation at an earlier stage. If we'd been able to engage with people who were actually at the sharp end of predatory lending practices in the country.
A practical example of how it would make a difference. Maria, you then talked about the plain and transparent language, but I was struck, in a way you were also arguing that even if we accept all the recommendations at face value, that in itself should not be the basis on which we proceed. There needs to be some work done to understand whether people accept and think that those would be the things that made the difference themselves. That, is that what you were trying to suggest?
So, for example, we had the idea floating through our group of 19 that maybe you could put leaflets in supermarkets of, like, how does the difference between parliament and government, who's your local MSP, you know, regional, dependent, and we as a group liked it quite well. But then when we took it forward to third-party groups that came in to talk about, well, the target groups, it wasn't all that well received. So I'm not. I'm of course now wondering. We are at risk of just if you just take our 19 people suggesting a face value. I believe you may be at risk of just wasting money. Uh-huh. You know, I mean, you could be spending thousands, tens of thousands of pounds on printing flyers, and then no one takes them, or just kids chuck them in the bin or something.
Yeah,
that would be a shame.
Okay, so that's a cautionary note, which is not just to blunder forward, but to think carefully about how we progress with the recommendations. Okay, Ronnie, the bus. You seem to be the bus advocate. This has already caught a certain amount of media attention, and I was interested to. I don't know. Well, let's see what the colleagues think. Did the colleagues have any thoughts in relation to the bus? David,
as somebody who lives in the central belt and everything's focused around the central belt, I think for communities out in rural communities and hard to engage areas, and especially areas of deprivation, which many of us have in our constituency, I think the bus is a great way for the public to engage with Parliament, because how many people in rural communities ever see the Parliament or what the Parliament does or engage with the Parliament? And especially, now take it to the other side, I've got some of the highest areas of deprivation in Scotland. It's very, very difficult to communicate with them. So something like a bus going into their areas or into their community hubs would promote the Parliament and what it does and how they could engage with Parliament. So I think it's a really, really good idea.
Paul?
Yeah, I think the concept is really interesting. I mean, the only example I can think of was in Poppy Scotland, converted this old truck into a sort of mobile exhibition about the First World War. It went round Scotland and it actually was incredibly successful, particularly with young people, about educating. It was like a mobile museum almost. But it was very well put together. But I actually think it could be a wider thing, because a large part of the issue is that a lot of people don't actually know where the Parliament fits in the broader range of concerns that they might have in relation to local government issues and UK Parliament issues. So actually we have a broader, potentially educational opportunity to sort of discuss more generally what's the role of the councillor, the member of the Scottish Parliament, the member of the UK Parliament in relation to your local issues, local needs, and how you engage effectively with all the institutions in our democratic society. So I think it could be a broader enterprise. It could be quite successful. It would be worth testing out. And even just like the point about what is the Parliament's function in relation to holding power to account as well, I think it's really important, because I think it just all merges into one blob in the mind of the public, and I think actually teasing that out would be quite useful. One of the things I've actually often thought would be really good is a sort of long-running fly-in-the-wall documentary that gets into the mechanics of how Parliament operates on a day-to-day basis, and it, you know, like Inside Central Station on BBC, and actually just, it's a long-running programme, it's a kind of public service broadcasting thing that covers councils, covers Parliament, covers both Parliaments, you know, and actually just deals with what it's like day-to-day, rather than it, not in a political sense, but in actually the kind of mechanical sense of how it all operates. I think it would be a very effective tool for getting the public aware of how it actually works on a day-to-day basis, rather than it being the political theatre that's all they ever see. I keep pitching this to the BBC, but I don't know if they're ever going to take me on for it.
I mean, interestingly, similar such fly-in-the-wall documentaries have been done in both the House of Commons and the House of Lords. They've not been about the party politics, but about the clerks, the speaker, the way in which the engineers, the maintenance crews, the security. So, but it's been about how the actual mechanics of the Parliament operate, not really about the political business that goes on in a party pejorative sense. And I think even for people who are involved in politics, seeing the workings of other parliaments, so it's very engaging. You know, you get to you get to learn how that works. I was interested, though, Ronnie, in relation to the bus, because there's a couple of words in there, and I just wanted to understand what you meant. The bus could be, I don't want to call it a travelling museum, but it could be a travelling exhibit that is an educational tool that shows people how Parliament works. But then I also see that it says here it could talk to people about their issues, and that presumes then that there are people with the bus who are able to talk to people. And what I wanted to try and understand is, did you mean that to be an active political engagement talking, as in MSPs from different parties would be part of the bus within the different communities? Or did you see the bus more as educational officials from the Parliament who would be there to explain the function and how Parliament works? I mean, I'm trying to draw a distinction between those two functions, because was it both? You know, it would be in a place for long enough that there might be sessions where it was about the mechanics, or there might be sessions where it was, if you like, a focal point for the public who sometimes find it difficult to engage with politicians to know that they could come and do so. Mindful, of course, in the modern world of the security both for them in doing so and the politicians and others who would be involved. What did you see its function being when it was out and about?
I thought it could be more than just educational. I mean, there is educational engagement, but one of the very first things that was brought up when we started this journey was why do people not engage? And one of the words that was used was trust. And I think there's an opportunity going out in person in some sort of mobile unit and just explore and maybe do a wee bit more to engage with people and build that trust. How that's done, I don't know, but I think it's worth exploring. Because the personal, and I think a lot of our recommendations are about engagement, knowledge, trust, and they all sort of merge together. And this would be one of the tools that could be used to go out into the communities that don't engage at all and maybe just build a wee bit of trust somewhere along the road and give them a wee bit of knowledge. And I don't think that's ever going to be a bad thing.
Yeah, because we've had examples here of some of the different engagement buses that go around the country, whether it be major power companies or whether it be ones about diet and how people might live better, or whether it be about health. There was one here not so very long about liver function and things, and people went out. And a lot of these buses now can expand out the sides to create quite a big, big room that, you know, the whole thing opens out. To create quite a big working space. So we've certainly had engagement with organisations investing in that kind of operation. But I think the key thing for me in it would be, coming back to Maria's point about maybe just doing more research and things, is the worst thing would be is if we spent a lot of money in a bus and then sent it out to find a purpose rather than us having an idea what that purpose should be, which was validated by research we'd already done with people as to what they would like it to do when it was going to be in their community. Because what you wouldn't want was a blue and white elephant, for want of a better, purple and white elephant, for want of a better description. You'd want it to do something. So I'm intrigued that you saw it as a more than just a kind of, here is what happens, but we're discussing issues today and we would like in your community for you to come along and participate in that discussion, is essentially kind of the kind of thing you're saying as well. We'd have to be careful. I mean, I don't think it could really be a surgery bus, because there wouldn't be the ability to have private conversations with people about, you know, highly personal issues that they might be struggling with. But it's certainly one where we could, I can imagine you could have more open discussions. David?
I think if the bus is going to go out, it has to be something that promotes a Parliament, how they could engage with a Parliament and how a Parliament could help them engage. I think once you add politicians, another dimension comes in which would skew whiff the whole process. We all know what's going to happen. We all take our own self-interests to heart.
Surely not.
No, we all know it. Let's be open on this, right? No matter what, right? And I think if a bus is going to go out there, you keep politicians well clear of it. I do. I really, really do.
Oh, I'm tempted to say, David, that may be how they do things in the SNP, but it's certainly not how they do things in my party.
And I'm not believing that either.
But I wouldn't do that to you. Well, I mean, that is, I think, what we can look into. Yeah. But I mean, I think it's certainly an idea that we've not considered as a parliament, particularly given that the parliament did, particularly in its early years, the pandemic hasn't helped in the last session, have much more of a proactive engagement. I know we come to Parliament days as another of the areas that we talk about. Maria, you've very personally felt committed to the next of these comments, which is when the Parliament actually meets in order for people to be able to engage with it. And what did you mean by that? I mean, what would you like to see? Were you saying that from time to time you would like to see a Saturday sitting of the Parliament? Or what was it you would like to happen? Or what if there was something happening out with the normal working hours of the week, what is it you would like to see happening then that you might then have felt interested in engaging with?
Well, on the one hand, being able to meet with MSPs, either in the evenings, early evenings, for example, or on the weekends, or having just an online portal where you can write down your ideas or your grievances, and which then can be put forward to members of parliament, for example.
Okay. Colleague, no? Okay, that's helpful. And then we've got the web page. So I think we'll move on to the second section. Sorry,
just on the point five of community engagement, and Maria's, is that not what MSPs are meant to do with surgeries at weekends and things like that? So make sure the public can easily get to them to engage.
But there's a distinction between that and engaging with the parliamentary apparatus, yes, potentially. And I suppose we do talk about cross-party groups later on, because actually I was interested in the importance that was attached to all of that. And of course, the parliament doesn't really facilitate cross-party groups particularly. So that may be something that out of this report needs to be looked at again. Can I move on to the second? Thank you very much, both of you. And the next section is going to be led by Ronnie and John. And that is on how Parliament uses deliberative democracy. So, Ronnie, John, I don't know which of you is kicking off first.
Do you want to take it, Ronnie?
I'm not unmuted.
You're on.
Hello?
Yeah.
I'm on.
Yeah.
John, could I ask you, could you do paragraph 7 first and I'll do the other three? Would that be okay?
Perfect. Okay, so we talked about deliberative democracy. We heard quite a lot about it. We heard the pros, we heard the cons, and quite importantly, we heard that it's a tool to be used with discretion. We did feel that if it's going to be used, it needs to be embedded in legislation, so there's a proper framework for it. You know, we've got the bold text here that the reason to legislate for democracy, deliberative democracy, is in order to ensure that diverse voices and communities from all parts of Scotland influence Scottish Parliament's work and the public are consistently informed and consulted on local and national issues. We went through and padded out the recommendation a bit, again, recognising that it's not a one solution for everything situation and it would have to be used in the appropriate places. And that an appropriate framework would have to be designed. Coming back to Paul's earlier point, we did actually use the analogy of jury service for the protection side. The reason that word doesn't appear in this recommendation is we didn't want there to be any hint at all of it being compulsory. We like all the protections that come from jury service, time off from work, no backlash for taking time from work, expenses being covered, all of that, but we just want it to be very clear that there should be no compulsion beyond a similar process to how we were recruited. The letter's going out. If you're interested, fill this in. If not, put the letter in the bin, I guess, which I'm sure is what happened with a lot of the letters. We quite like the idea of the annually recurring citizens panel with agenda setting powers. One of the Jonathan from Belgium discussed that quite a bit, and we really quite liked how that worked, and the idea of actually, you know, giving a representative group of the public the ability to decide, or in partially decide, what's at the top of the list for discussion was really attractive to us. One of the other things that came up during that conversation was the idea of having MSPs directly involved in the panels themselves, very much as a minority and very much set up so they don't overtake the conversation. But it was very much felt that if they're in there meeting the panelists and get a bit invested, it's more likely that things will go forward to fruition. I think that's all I have on seven. Ronnie?
Point eight that we put forward was to build a strong evidence base for deliberative democracy to determine its effectiveness and develop a framework for measuring impact. And I think on that point, it goes back to what we said, that we came together as a group. And I think we've shown that's quite a strong evidence base in itself, that it can work. Point number nine, build cross-party support for deliberative democracy, as this is needed for it to work. And that is a crucial thing, because we, at the moment, we have like elective democracy, representative democracy, and deliberative democracy is quite a bit away from that. So I don't know if there's a rub between the two of them. So, but we definitely need to look into how we build cross-party support for that. And the point 10, the final one in this section, was we recommend that one of the panels should be set up, specifically a people's panel, to discuss MSP's code of conduct. And I think this goes back to the idea of trust and public accountability in this area. sorry. I know there might be questions regarding it.
Yeah. John, can I come back to you? I mean, I was interested in in 2 points, and obviously I'll bring in colleagues as well. When you talk about the recommendations of a timeline from which responses might be received, one of the issues arising from this whole inquiry, which has exercised colleagues on the committee ahead of us beginning our inquiry, is the sense of expectation that is raised amongst those who are participating and what happens to the work that they have done. And is there an understanding that, and in fact Maria perhaps confirmed that there is, that any group of people can come forward with a series of recommendations, but it doesn't necessarily mean that those recommendations are recommendations which can be or should be pursued, because when you look into them further with other people, they may not find wider favour. But is the suggestion here about a sort of building in a process timeline a response to that kind of concern about expectations, so that there is a deliverable end result for those people who have participated? Is that the reasoning with that?
Very much so. Across this whole process, if we go back to the barriers from section one, one of the barriers is, why should I bother? You know, times are tough for people now. Everybody has constraints on time, as Maria's point out. And there was a general feeling that, why should I bother engaging? It's going to make no difference at all. Now, not everything that's suggested is going to go forward. We're all adults. We all accept that. But if you don't ever hear feedback, then that reinforces the why should I bother mentality. We address a little bit later in our recommendations having a really solid framework for feedback. But everyone I've spoken to amongst my social circle talking about this, that's come up. And, you know, if something's not going to happen, just tell us. Don't leave it in limbo. And that also feeds into Ronnie's recurrent point about trust. You know, we need to trust you, but you need to trust us. And part of that is, if something we say is impractical or just isn't going to fit with the general direction of travel, tell people. Let them know in a reasonable time scale. And also, if that time scale is structured, people will also know, well, it's only been X amount of time. They're going to get back to me in Y amount of time. So I know I've not been forgotten yet. So the timeline is particularly important, I think, Jackson. And it's actually, there's a whole later recommendation that addresses it.
Which we'll come to. Thank you. And one other question arose for me here. And you talk about an annually recurring citizens panel. I just wondered, was this born out of your own experience? So did you imagine thereby the Parliament hosting a weekend event like the one in which you all participated, or did you see a different framework for the annual citizens panel? Because it in your suggestions here would almost be leading the initiative of what would follow in terms of local panels and communities in terms of the agenda items that might be being set. So would it have a life of its own, or would it have, as your panel did, a sort of genesis here in the Parliament?
We were very open to debate on that one. It was an idea that Jonathan Moskowitz with the Belgian group had discussed quite a lot, and a lot of us found that idea quite attractive. We found, just broadly talking about the whole process, we met over two weekends, a couple of online sessions, and there was a whole journey there from, as you saw on the first evening, 19 people sort of staring at each other a little bit nervously till the last hour on the final Sunday and the sessions that came after that, a group of people really forging something ahead. In the idea of an annual thing, it probably would start with a fresh group each year, because that would kind of be the point. It would have to have sufficient time to actually get that bond, because, as I just said, there's a process of the group coming together to being effective. I think in old-fashioned management speak, it's storming, norming, performing. And that would be quite a thing. How it's actually taken forward from that in terms of having regional panels, I think that would need more research done. But it's definitely something that should be looked at.
Okay. Paul, David, do you have any questions in this section you're prompted to ask?
I fully agree with it. I think I have nothing really to add to it. I think,
David?
No, the only one I might have is recommendation 10 about a panel should be set up to discuss an MSP's code of conduct. That's really quite interesting, because you know the difficulties we've had in Parliament in the past with the code of conduct and the behaviour of some MSPs. So,
we do have a code of conduct, so I was struck with that too, and I wondered, code of conduct could cover so many different things. Was there something that the panel, as people watching MSPs perform, felt that the code of conduct could address that they felt maybe the existing codes don't? I suppose that...
I was really interested in that, because is it, oh, my MSP doesn't hold any surgeries, or he's not engaging with my community, can we hold him to account for that? Or
Ronnie?
If I can be brutally frank, there is that general mistrust of politics that's come up over the last few years, and we might as well address it. Having public engagement in set up a code of conduct, I don't think the code of conduct would necessarily change a huge amount. Maybe some recommendations. One thing that was made very clear to us is each MSP is a sovereign entity, and how they manage their constituency matters is down to them. And I don't think a code should necessarily address that as a code, but we talk later about minimum standards of response, and that's something that could maybe be worked in there. But if anything, it would be an opportunity for the public to say, this is what I expect from my MSP. And I strongly believe there'll be a 99% overlap anyway, but actually having that engagement would be the biggest builder of trust you could do, apart from the feedback. And that trust, as Ronnie said, as everyone said, is quite essential, I think.
Ronnie, did you want to come in on that?
I think it came about for me when I read through the code of conduct, and there's not a lot of it to begin with. And I have watched some things on television too with Parliament, and probably not very happy with some of the things that happen in there, like others, whether it's showboating or whatever. And that's it's unappealing to watch, and doesn't give a lot of trust out sometimes. So I think the reason I brought that in was, is there some area to look at where we can build a bit more trust, a bit more public responsibility, a bit more transparency in what people do, how they conduct themselves, the things that they say in Parliament, which ran along one of our other points that we've made about more power to the Speaker in the House as well. And I just think that's very important, that we have that transparency and honesty. And sometimes we look at these things, like myself in television, and it just isn't there at times.
Mm-hmm. Well, so that's what was intriguing me, was just where this was coming from, because I wondered whether you were identifying politicians who go and spend time in the jungle. Obviously, there's a Conservative politician from Westminster who's done that, and previously a Labour politician from the Scottish Parliament who has taken themselves off to spend time in the jungle with celebrities. So whether it was that sort of thing you had in mind, or whether, and you referred there to the showboating, dear me, that showboating of politicians in the Parliament. Heavens, I'm sure I've been accused of that from time to time. It's sometimes the only way we keep ourselves entertained. But I mean, was it the absence of evidence of individuals doing a function or abdicating that responsibility, or was it their conduct in undertaking that responsibility in Parliament? And I should say, actually, one of the complicating issues in these things is that there are half of the members here, of which David and I are examples, who are elected first past the post to represent a specific constituency, and half of our colleagues, Paul being an example, who are elected to represent a broader region. And the work streams, I think, that we have are nuanced differently because of those different responsibilities. So what might seem an appropriate diet of work for a constituency MSP is quite different if you're representing a region. So I'm not trying to be difficult here, I'm just trying to understand what it was that had exercised the feeling that this would be useful.
I think when it goes back to my lack of knowledge about the working of government and et cetera, et cetera, and myself probably just as a normal member of the public who dip in occasionally and watch TV, et cetera, et cetera. And this sometimes mistrust of things that we see. So I think that's where it came from. So, and my idea was, well, how do we change that? How do we build trust? And how do we have transparency? And how do we have some sort of public accountability? And whether it's through a look at the code of conduct or something else, I don't know.
Okay, thank you. We'll move then on to the third section, which is public involvement in parliamentary business. And Gillian, who's been sitting patiently, but Gillian, you and John are going to lead on this section.
Okay. Section 11 is, carry out a cost-benefit analysis of the Parliament itself or communities meeting outside of Holyrood and compare this to A, more support and targeted invitations for people to come to Holyrood, and B, reinstating Parliament days, MSPs going out in the communities for a day of activity. There's no point in doing this if it's going to cost an absolute fortune and no one's going to turn up, you know, to look at it. So you probably need to look at the costs of it first, and how the general public would engage with that. The more supported targeted invitations for people to come to Holyrood, when we were invited here in the first place, there was, I believe, 4,800 invitations went out, just randomly selected from the Royal Mail. And then you registered your interest and you were selected after that. And one of the things that we were doing throughout all this was to target the people who just looked at that, threw it in the bin and said, that's not for me. You know, it's trying to get them to look again and be more involved in the Parliament, because the Parliament's separate from the government. We all found that out now. We didn't really know that at first. So the MSPs going out into the communities for a day of activity just to, you know, not look at specific groups, but again, could be on the buses or whatever and just go out and just speak to the people. They have surgeries, but going into the actual surgery where the MP is can be quite daunting for people. If you take yourselves out to their communities and just allow them to just say what's the hold up here, I think you'd get a really good response.
Okay.
Okay. Recommend number 12 was set a 9-month deadline as a default for feedback on any outcomes of the engagement with clear reasons where the deadline would not be met if applicable.
And this is the thing John referred to a moment ago when I talked about a more detailed programme. Yeah. Fair enough.
The live status of the decision-making progress should be clear and transparent throughout, because if people put an idea through to Parliament and they don't get any response or any clear response within a deadline, we're getting round to it, that's when they disengage, because they don't feel that they'll ever get round to their issue. So instead of just, you could create a minimum standard response, the initial acknowledgement of engagement is yes, we've got that, and follow up to explain how many responses and what happens next. You know, like how are you going to deal with this next? And that sort of looking up. So follow up with the information on the outcome of the inquiry, if you look at it, well, are we doing that? Signposted with more information. Where can they get the information from? And a traffic light system for inquiries, flagging up what's been addressed and what hasn't. Monitoring calls logged and establishing rules on how long someone would have to wait for a response. The clerks here, we've interacted with them really well, you know, for throughout the process, and they're very, very keen for the public engagement, as are yourselves. And it would show people that their participation is worthwhile and make people feel that their voice is being heard. Legislation inquiries can take a long time, so set expectations and from the start and consider how it will keep people involved in the longer term. If you do this, it will feel empathy. If you don't do this, it'll empathy and mistrust.
Okay, thank you.
So that leads us on to anyone 13.
This one if you want, Gillian.
No,
it's fine, I'll do.
Ronnie asked a question when the chief executive was there. And
David
McGill. And I can't remember what the question was. However, David did respond and say that we can't ask people to answer the question. So if we said, well, if you've not got the power to do that, let's give the presiding officer the power to compel MSPs to answer to all questions asked. That is a direct reply and is relevant to the question. And this should include a process for a deferred answer if an immediate answer cannot be given. You know, like if they don't know, just say, I don't know, but I'll find out, I'll get back. And this will improve public trust and engagement.
And that's excited quite a bit of attention.
Oh, yeah.
And it is interesting because, well, we can come back to it, because the Commission on Parliamentary Reform, of which I was a member, also looked at this area. And other parliaments, one in Ireland, for example, Republic of Ireland, where the equivalent of the presiding officer there, it can say that a question has not been answered, and that is regarded as a fairly significant admonishment, which has led to that power not having to be exercised because nobody wants to be found to have fallen short of not delivering an answer, and it's worked quite well. And then we've got one more recommendation. John, are you taking this one?
Yeah, we talked about scheduling specific time for individual public questions. We weren't quite sure ourselves the best format for this. We didn't want it to be too staged like we saw with some things a few years ago, but we also saw examples of quite powerful times where an individual direct question has been asked, you know, from an individual member of the public directly to a minister. And it's been quite powerful to see. And we do feel that as a form of engagement, it has some real potential if it's set up properly. It's a bit of a vague recommendation because we weren't sure quite what the best way to do it was, but we really do think it's something worth looking at.
Okay. Paul?
I'm very sympathetic to this point because I think the issue of contempt for Parliament is something that is not well enforced, and it's something that I've found to be really frustrating, particularly in chamber business. So I think enhanced powers for the presiding officer to compel a relevant answer and also to compel timely and succinct answers in order not to kind of act... It's almost like responses can then become antisocial because they consume time and it's actually filibustering to an extent. If you just haver on for a minute and a half in response to a question about, you know, without getting to the point, then it's actually designed to push other questions off the shelf, if you know what I mean, so they can not have as many questions. So I think there is an issue with it. I think in other legislatures, like the Irish Doyle, for example, the presiding officer has the right to say, stop.
Exactly.
You know, so I think there's that element of, you know, you should treat this with the respect you would treat a courtroom, in the sense that you should be giving relevant and punchy answers to, or and indeed the question should be succinct and to the point, not going on often a sort of preamble that's a minute long, you know. So I think there's maybe something to that about tightening up the standing orders to make the Parliament more rigorous in terms of how the questions in particular are addressed.
Thank you. I mean, I know whenever I'm playing fantasy presiding officer, I have often thought that I would ban notes with exceptions, obviously, for people who require that for various reasons. But certainly the banning of notes that are read out as speeches during questions, notes only to which can be referred. And I would, if I would like to have seen the presiding officer having the power to say, Minister, this is not an opportunity for you to read out a speech. You are answering a question and you may refer to the note, but you can't just spend the next 3 minutes reading it out. And I think that can be quite a frustrating part of it, because very often the 3 minute exposition doesn't get anywhere near answering the question that was originally put. And, you know, the members get very frustrated and are then told that the presiding officer's got no control over what the minister has said. And I think that would be a way of addressing that, Paul.
There's also an interesting one. There's a balance. Like, for example, at Prime Minister's questions, which I've had the opportunity to participate in as well, the Prime Minister won't give advance sight of the questions. It's just numbered with names. So it's just sudden death. And you have that's why there's this kind of stack of notes, really, like, kind of frantically. But frequently it will be really interesting point. I'll get my officials, the relevant minister, to respond. And that's usually quite good when it's a constituency issue, because it tends to escalate the matter very rapidly and you tend to get actually quite a decent outcome. So I just wonder, rather than having that kind of preamble on the face of the order paper where then there's already a prescripted response. I mean, sometimes that's helpful if you want to get a detailed answer on something and you actually would volunteer to give the information to the minister in advance. I just think it'd be an interesting way of changing it up a bit to see whether that format would actually improve, you know, relevant responses, you know, or well, at least make people a bit keener to respond.
This can't become a dialogue between you and I, but in fact, the Commission on Parliamentary Reform looked at that too, but there was quite a strong resistance from government to allowing that to be as open as that, on the basis they argued that they would give less constructive answers to questions. But, I mean, in the 2011-2016 Parliament, I was able to attend Parliament open days in Oban, Dumfries and Stornoway. And it was interesting. The one in Stornoway was very well supported by the public. There was an evening event that had several hundred people at it. Whether that was because we were on one of the islands and maybe the whole concept of the Parliament coming there was, you know, very much different. I can't remember, David, were you in the Petitions Committee at that
point?
Yes,
I was.
You remember that? You'll come in on that as well. We went to one in Oban that was quite well supported, and we went to one in Dumfries that wasn't very well supported at all. And it was interesting, having been to the one in Stornoway, which was a big success, I thought, this is wonderful, only to then go to Parliament days in other places, and nobody seemed very interested in coming to it at all. But I do think that they were worthwhile initiatives that could be thought through and taken forward further. But it comes back a little bit to Maria's point earlier about ensuring that what you're doing is something people, in which people actually do want to participate. David?
That point 11 was what I was going to come to. Nobody would be surprised that I'm somebody who promotes the Parliament and the committees going out into the communities. And the examples that you've given, Convener, the other one was at Loch Fyne when we went to see if Rest and Be Thankful. And
well, that was the Oban one. I was
the Oban one, yes. And that was quite well attended, if you remember. Yeah. Because I think I chaired it that day. And I think that engagement with, because it just wasn't going out there for what the committee was designed to do. At the end of every one of them, we had a session with the public just for a general question and answer about how the Parliament worked. And it was really good to see it promoted that way.
I mean, it's important to say to our visitors that part of that Parliament day was a public session of the Public Petitions Committee, which both David and I were on. And we were hearing petitions that had been raised by people from those communities specifically, one or two which led to fundamental changes on behalf of the community that, I mean, I think of what was known as the Tinker's Heart, which was a historical landmark, burial ground almost, of people from the travelling community, and the fact that it was a very poor state of repair. It subsequently became adopted with formal access. So that was actually why we were participating, and it was, I think, quite invigorating to actually go out to where the petition had originated rather than having to bring the petitioners in here. Any other questions on this session? I mean, I'll come back then to the, because I have reflected on point 14, which is your panel of questions from the public. Was this because you've seen the way in which digital communications have improved that would allow the public to participate in that way? Or were you imagining what? I mean, a formal session of the Parliament where members of the public could be present, or where their questions would be introduced digitally? Or was it really just the concept
open? We discussed a number of different options, and we'd looked at things that happened before, from simple things like an MSP reading a question that they've been sent by a constituent, through to, you know, them appearing on video, as we saw during COVID briefings, through to them attending personally. And we thought all of those had merit, and it would really be a case of needing further research and discussion as to what would, you know, be best. Speaking personally and directly, I quite like the idea of a member of public directly in the chamber. It just seems more authentic to me, but I think the other ideas would work just as well.
Okay, thank you. That brings us then to the final section, which is communication and education, and Paul and Gillian are going to lead on this section. Paul MacDonald this time.
Well, Gillian, do you want to start?
Use media outlets, documentaries and short films to highlight Parliament's successes and real-life stories of engagement to improve public perception and trust. One of the main things that I found, obviously, with giving the presiding officer, was when I was speaking to colleagues and friends, was why would I engage with the Parliament? I don't trust them. They don't answer questions. They waffle for 20 minutes and say nothing. So they were as blunt as that, sorry. Use media outlets, documentaries and short films. That would actually highlight the successes that you have, because some of the successes are really good and people don't, you know. So it needs to do more to tell people about the engagement and participation work, as those it reaches are positive about the experience. If we can speak to people who have had a really positive experience about engaging with Parliament, I think the word of mouth actually probably does more to support the situation. Radio, TV, newspapers, community groups. Public sometimes find it easier to digest information by way of another person rather than TV.
Okay.
The Parliament should run more general information campaigns explaining the role of the Scottish Parliament, brochures, leaflets. Basically, I think there's a lot of mistrust in politics, is where this came from, in general. And if people sort of understood there was a separation, then they might be more keen to engage with Parliament, because it's less, it almost seems it's like it's less political, it's less... it's less polarising than some of the political landscape at the moment, and particularly there's sort of, I feel there's been a lessening of trust in government. So if people appreciated there was a sort of division, and there was there's an organisation which is more impartial, that's working for them, they're more likely to get involved in it, rather than just sort of sit as an outsider and be angry about what's happening in the in their country as such. Do you want to point 17?
Point 17 is something that one of my colleagues was quite passionate about. The Parliament should hold an inquiry into the relationship between the aims of the current curriculum and the Parliament to explore systematic changes that can be made throughout schools and in communities to improve children and young people's knowledge and awareness of Parliament and deliberative democracy, including through mentorships, internships and competitions. And we had a vision collectively that by the Parliament's 25th anniversary, there should be a clear plan in place so that the Parliament's 30th anniversary, all young people of voting age have a clear understanding and knowledge about engaging with Parliament and government, and all see engaging with Parliament as a normal aspect of everyday life. And therefore, we wouldn't have panels on teaching how to engage.
Thank you. Okay, any questions from Paul or David in this section?
I think, Convener, it's a really, really powerful set of recommendations. I think we all know we get repeat customers as casework inquiries, and it can often be a core set of people who are always coming back to you for issues because they've tapped into the mechanism of how to do it. And it doesn't mean it's widely known about how to do it. It can be quite an arcane procedure to get, and it can also be quite intimidating to get in touch with an MSP or an MP, and I think perhaps making that more accessible would be useful. And certainly there's these kind of mass email campaigns that we get from time to time, where a campaign organisation will create an information box where you punch in your address and then you fill out a model response on a campaign issue, and you can get thousands of like duplicate emails basically, and you have to kind of do a kind of mass response to, which can be fine in terms of perfunctory engagement, but it's broadly to signal mass interest in a particular issue, but it isn't a close engagement issue. But what I might suggest is there a way for the Parliament to create a better interface for people to write to their MSP? You know, whether it's a matter of scanning a QR code on a bus shelter advertisement, you know, and it brings up a pro forma where it's, here's your MSP's, you know, constituency and regional, what is the nature of your issue, and here's the text to fill out the box, and it makes it easier to then send an email. It might be less intimidating than having to sit and, you know, manually type it all out and everything else. It might make it somewhat more simpler. Or you might actually have a callback service. Someone's requested a callback on an issue, so, you know, if they wanted to get a phone call, or a surgery booking service or something. Maybe there's a better interface being run through the Parliament's own website to do that kind of thing, rather than it being relying on individual MSPs to have social media and websites that offer that kind of, which could be highly variable in terms of quality. Just a thought about whether making, I mean, there is like They Work For You, which is that kind of website which makes engagement a bit easier, but again, it might not be the easiest of interfaces.
I'm certainly struck by this conflation of Parliament and government. I mean, I suppose cynically sometimes people within the Parliament think the government thinks that Parliament is part of the government, when in fact Parliament is not. And it is interesting, I suppose, when I reflect that most of the communications people receive are from either A, the government itself, through mailings relating to the pandemic, for example, where the government felt it had to communicate, or through national government priorities, which have been the subject of mailings to households. Or they hear from individual MSPs, potentially by way of an annual report, which isn't able or shouldn't be party political. The Parliament doesn't fund that. So, but sometimes I know some members find it difficult for it not then just to be a collection of photos of things they've done, because there's a limit in what they can actually describe by way of the activity they've entered into. Or I suppose people receive leaflets from political parties, which of course are much more pejorative and tend, because we live in a United Kingdom with two parliaments, very often to be directed at nothing in particular in terms of an institution, but to, you know, to politics elsewhere. So I'm struck by the fact that you very much felt, as part of the exercise you were all in, that blurring of what Parliament and government was very much one that had kind of affected your thinking of the distinction of this as an institution with which the public can engage quite directly and separately from government itself. Paul, is that correct?
Yeah, that was certainly a sort of a feeling that I picked up in the panel, in the group. And I think it's just general. It's not related to politics in Scotland, but just through the media, global media, and from Donald Trump to Boris Johnson, people have just sort of have less trust of government in general, or of the whole institution, and are less likely to get involved in it or engaged, because it seems so unjust and so illogical. But if they were aware that there was a more supportive organisation, a sort of a, like I say, an institution that's impartial, then yeah, they might be more keen to get involved.
And the final recommendation on the inquiry, now, as it happens, I also sit in the Scottish Parliament's corporate body, which is the body which is entrusted with running the functional aspects of the Parliament. And one of the groups that we hear from is the Parliament's educational unit that engages with schools. And I know they have very much been involved in the last few months on trying to understand how they reach the many schools that don't currently seek to try and participate with the Parliament. We get lots of educational groups you may see them if you're watching in the gallery behind in the lower section of the public gallery. But it's quite often the same schools that have been coming every year and lots of schools that haven't. And I'm just quite interested that you obviously touched on this area, Gillian, as being something that needed to be looked at in some detail. And you talk about potential mentorships, internships, which of course could sometimes be controversial because, you know, people feel that that's unpaid labour or whatever, and more competitions. But you felt that the group in the Parliament who are currently looking at this are right to be looking at it, because there's a need to think of different ways to encourage the active interest of young people.
It has to be non-partisan as well, I would imagine, so that it's not just indoctrinating one political party, yeah. That it is a collective group throughout its Parliament, not a political party, that teaches the young people how to engage a lot better.
David?
Thank you, Convener. I really think that point 17 is really important, because if we could engage with young people and reach out to them, they will engage with Parliament a lot easier in their later life. Because if you look at it, the Parliament's only just over 20 years old. For many people in Scotland, this Parliament wasn't here when they were younger or even middle-aged. So it's very unlikely they would have engaged with it at any time in their life. So I think that's a really key point. And a bit about mentorship and internships and the competitions. As somebody who runs a competition for all the school kids for Christmas cards, I couldn't offer them a prize in the Parliament. As you know, it's not allowed. You know, like a day out in the Parliament and you get a meal or whatever. It's just not allowed to do anything like that. So it's something I think it should be looked at.
Yes.
Because that way I've got six or seven primary schools engaged in my Christmas card competition, which is great.
Yes, the same thing. But there, as you say, we currently actually almost put obstacles in, yes, the way of participation with schools. And it can be quite difficult for politicians to be proactive, because some schools are sensitive to the idea that that might be not necessarily promoting the work of the Parliament, but promoting a particular political ideology, and all of that can create local education authorities to be concerned. But I think that's important. Well, listen, thank you all very much. I mean, that's been a really fascinating conversation. I thought I'd just go back round each of you again, just for a final thought that you'd like to leave us as a committee with. Ronnie, I'll do it the same order I did when I started. So what would you like to say to us as a final thought?
Just very quickly, I think as an exercise that it's been a great success with the recommendations that we brought forward as a group. To do that together, just as a random group, I think has been amazing. And I'd love to see it again, whether it's on a national level or maybe a local issue level. I think it'd be great to take that forward. And I would recommend, if anybody ever has a chance to do anything like this, just jump into it neck deep.
Okay. Maria?
I would just like to ask you to not give up if something doesn't immediately stick. So if you try something out and within the first 2 months you don't feel like you have enough people, keep going with it. It may take a while for word to get out that it even exists, and then the people will come.
And then, I can't remember if I went to John or Paul next. I'll come to you, Paul, this time.
I was surprised when, from the panel, how many people have been always been keen to engage or have had strongly held views that they've wanted to feedback from the through the panel. It's really a free resource for the Parliament to use. There's so many people that are willing to put work in for very little cost, and there's a technology to make it very low cost as well. And ultimately, it will benefit everyone, because it will make people give people a greater feeling of ownership and trust within the country and within the government itself. So I think anything that can boost the trust of the political establishments as well can be hugely beneficial.
Thank you. Gillian?
I would say that, you know, the Scottish Government and yourselves, if you've got aspirations to be a world leader in democracy, let's get the trust there first. Let's get the honesty. Let's get people engaging, because they know they're going to get a reply and they're going to get it in a timely manner and an honest one. And I love the experience.
And John?
I'd like to repeat Maria's point that I think this is going to be a long-term goal, and I hope you guys really do stick with it. I'd like to take a second to thank the anonymous staff who've made this experience fascinating and have managed us so well. They've let us wander our own path, but somehow kept us from falling off the cliff. And finally, I look forward to hearing feedback on this.
Well, thank you very much. So to Ronnie Patterson, to Paul McDonald, Gillian Rain, John Saltman and Maria Schwartz, thank you all very much for joining us today. Thank you to you and to your colleagues who participated. I know your kind thanks to the many officials who were involved in assisting will have been noted and are appreciated. And yes, we look forward to discussing the report, taking it out for further consultation and discussion with our colleagues. And yes, I hope that you will feel that it, in due course, produces results which you feel have been worthwhile. So thank you all very much, and I'll now briefly suspend the committee for a few moments. Thank you.